right, guys, welcome back to another Skin Health Reversal video. And today I want to address the question of what are the best foods for psoriasis? So as usual, I'm going to kind of have a roundabout way of answering this because I feel like I have to. Because as I'm always saying to you guys, you know, the diet that works best for you and the foods that work best for you, this is not a one size fits all thing. This is a very individualized process. And in order to figure that out, you, in one way or another, have to go through this process of figuring this out on your own. Which foods, which macronutrient ratios work best for you and your health indicators? Things like energy, digestion, elimination, mood, sleep, strength. These are the things that are going to tell us if we're trending in the right direction with our diet and with our habits. But when it comes down to the best foods for psoriasis, I always find myself referring back to what I call the primal framework. The primal framework consists of five groups of foods. So this isn't five exact foods that I'm going to list off because, you know, as I said, what works for me might not work for you, or what works for some of my clients might not be the best path for you. So you're going to have to kind of figure out which specific foods are best for you. But like I said, I'm always referring to this primal framework. If you stick within this framework, you can find what foods work for you. I'm just going to run through these five groups of foods that the primal framework consists of. So the first food is animal proteins. So things like ruminant meats, beef, lamb, elk, bison, chicken, fish, eggs, bone broth, which is absolutely amazing for patching up leaky gut and reversing gut issues. This really you want this to be the foundation of your diet and what you aim for early on. Everybody needs a sufficient amount of protein. And I always say you want to aim for it near your body weight in grams. So if you weigh 160 pounds, eat around 160, maybe a little less, a little bit more grams of protein per day. But this should really be the focal point of a lot of your diets, is finding good quality animal proteins, making them a staple in your diet, and eating them every day. The second group of foods is fruits. So, you know, obviously there's a long list of fruits out there. Apples, pears, bananas, berries, avocados. And some of these fruits you might not respond favorably to, especially in the early stages of gut health reversal. It might be in your best interest to keep your fiber and your carbohydrates really low, just so you give your gut some time to relax and repair itself. And then as time goes on, you might be able to add in some of these more carbohydrate-dense and fiber-dense foods. You know, I think fruit is an amazing food. Sourcing, as always, is very important. Fruit is a fairly big part of my diet. Like I said, I consider myself pretty animal-based, and I like to focus on these animal proteins and animal fats, but I do not demonize carbohydrates, and fruit is one of the best ways for me to get them in there. The third food here is going to be vegetables. So me personally, I don't eat a ton of vegetables. I eat vegetables, some kind of vegetable, you know, just about every week, but I'm not super heavy on, you know, green vegetables. I do think, you know, there are health benefits to them, and I don't think you should demonize them or not consume them. But find, just like with the fruit and just like with, you know, the carbohydrates and the fiber, find your pocket with it. You might not need to eat, you know, these big salads all the time and just tons of green vegetables to be healthy. You know, for myself and a lot of other people, I found that, you know, I like to limit those things. But in terms of my digestion, I seem to do best when I keep my fiber generally low. And for the most part, I like to get my fiber from things like fruit, potatoes, things like that, kind of things that pack a little bit of a heavier carbohydrate and sugar punch. But some people are going to do better with more veg, you know, sticking maybe like lower carb, but adding in some more fiber through things like asparagus, sauteed spinach, lettuce, things like that, cucumber. So go ahead, eat your vegetables, but study your body and study how it responds to varying amounts and different amounts of vegetables. But find your limit with the vegetables. Don't feel the need to pound in a ton of them all the time. If you feel better eating, you know, larger amounts of them, then go ahead and do that. Vegetables, I think, are a great food and a great companion for these animal proteins. But you don't need to kill yourself and, you know, jam them down your throat all day. The fourth group of foods that I have for you guys today is tubers. So potatoes, things like potatoes, sweet potatoes. As you probably know, you know, if you look up online, you know, biggest psoriasis triggers, nightshades is probably going to be one of like the first things that pops up. But me personally, I eat nightshades very often, and you know, some of the people that I work with eat nightshades very often. I've seen people who have, you know, bad results when they do eat too many nightshades, and I've seen people who thrive on them. So I don't believe in demonizing any food and saying, you know, this food is undoubtedly bad for anyone with psoriasis, because, you know, I've seen lists that say eggs, red meat, and potatoes are just awful for psoriasis, but those are things that I eat just about every day. So, you know, figure that out. If potatoes seem to work well for you, include them in your diet. If they don't seem to work well for you, don't include them. And as with everything, you know, find your limit with it. And if you seem to have intolerance to nightshades, go for a sweet potato. See if that works for you. So I think, like I said earlier, I like throwing in potatoes a little bit more than, you know, these green vegetables, because it packs a little bit of a heavier punch and I like to get a lot of calories in. So throw in some potatoes, pay attention to your carbohydrate and fiber thresholds, and see how much you can handle, or if you can even handle them at all at this point. The last group of foods that I have for you guys is animal carbohydrates and dairy. So carbs and fiber sort of go hand in hand, but as I'm saying, a lot of people are figuring out that they don't need these huge amounts of fiber to get through the day. But someone like me, who feels like I need a little bit more carbs, you know, I need to get my carbs up in that 120, 150 range, especially on days when I'm, you know, more active and burning more calories, I like to get some carbohydrates in through fiberless sources. Things like raw goat milk, raw local honey, yogurt, things of that nature. And to go along, you know, with the dairy part of this, raw butter is just a complete staple in my diet. If you don't have access to it, don't worry about it. You know, go to the store, find the best quality, or order online. You know, find the best quality grass-fed butter that you can find and cook with it. You know, you don't really want to rely heavily on these oils when it comes to cooking. You want to get these good saturated fats in there, butter, tallow, things of that nature. Honey is an amazing food. You know, get some raw local honey, maybe contact a local farm. Great way to add in some healthy carbohydrates, healthy sugars, without bringing that fiber amount up too much. And then with the dairy thing, obviously this is another kind of touchy subject when it comes to health and gut health in general. But a lot of, as I've said in other videos, you know, a lot of the issues that I think people experience with dairy, it's a quality issue. You know, the stuff that you're getting at the stores is not always the best quality stuff. But butter, I think, is like a safe one that you can get from the store, as long as it's good quality grass-fed stuff. As I said, you know, a lot of us have been scared off from it in recent years, you know, with a lot of the things you read online. But what I found, and what a lot of people have found, is when you go out of your way to get some really good quality dairy and source it properly, it can have a, you know, a game-changing effect. So that's all I got for you guys. And I also want to make a point that you guys need to keep in mind that, especially during the early stages, as your gut health is just not in a great place and you're really trying to heal it, you might need to go to more of an extreme and not include include less foods in total. So, you know, sticking with a really animal-based, low-carb, low-fiber sort of approach for a period of time can be just an absolute great reset for you guys. And then from there, start to expand a little bit more, start experimenting with a little bit more of these fruits and these vegetables and potatoes and things like that. But if you're trying to reverse the state of your gut health, you want to start super simple. You know, I gave you guys this list, but you want to simplify that as much as possible, just so you can gather information and make refinements from there. That's a huge part about this, is when things aren't going right, what do? This is a huge process of refinements, and you need to know what to do when things aren't going right. But as I said, all I got for you guys, as usual, I'll leave a link below to naturalpsoriasishealing.com, where you can watch my proven psoriasis protocol training to get some insight on my skin health reversal system. You can apply for my one-on-one coaching program, and I also have a supplement regimen video on the website as well. So if you guys have any questions, leave some comments below. I just started this YouTube channel recently, so if you haven't subscribed yet, please do that, and I will see you guys in the next video.